The very purpose of this session is to empower you to write an answer which is containing current affairs substance. Current affairs is not sociology. When you see current affairs, you should be able to filter certain things which can be exactly fixed with your sociology syllabus. So I was going through a number of materials, especially the newspapers which you are seeing, and I have seen some of the books review based on which only I am holding a session on sociology in current affairs. So the first and the primary motive of this session is make you get extra few marks. A few couple of marks will definitely be decisive to your success in this civil services examination. So what extra you are doing when you compare yourself with others, this is what is going to decide the outcome of your preparation, what extra you have done. See, we wanted, always we wanted something which we do not have. We wanted something which we do not have. We are not IAS, which is why we wanted to become IAS. So we always wanted certain things which we do not have. If we wanted to have certain things which we do not have, we wanted to do certain things which we have not done. So we have not done certain things and we have to do it because we wanted to get what we do not have. Keeping this as the basic premise, assuming that most of you have not prepared explicitly current affairs substance to include in sociology, I am holding this session, right? So the purpose is few marks extra you have to get, few marks extra. If you get 5 marks extra, if you could score half a mark extra in every of your question, out of 19 questions you will score 10 marks in paper 1, you will score 10 marks in paper 2. Minimum half a mark if you get, you will be able to get 20 marks extra in your sociology. So this 20 marks is going to decide your fate actually. Why 20 mark? 5 mark extra if you could get because of this single session, I will be the happiest person on the earth. So the motivation is to empower your preparation, to get you that extra mark which you are very much wanting to clear this UPSC examination and enter into dream job of you, right? I have selected, I have browsed through, I have selected some 27 topics which I found that it is very relevant for your sociology syllabus. Most of the topics were centering around inequality, caste based inequality or gender based inequality and the resulting deprivations. Sociology is nothing but the study of social inequality and social exclusion. Many questions in sociology paper, they are very much relevant to this topic called as social exclusion. So the social exclusion, this is the dimension which I am putting forward in this current affairs class, which is relevant for your sociology syllabus. The very first question which comes to my mind is, if at all they are asking you a question like the social aspects of or social consequences of demonetization, simply sociology of demonetization, simply if they are throwing this question, then we should be able to write a sociological answer. Remember that you will have to write sociological answer, you should not write GS answer in sociology. So I am very specific in lifting the topics which are very much rooted in the sociology syllabus, otherwise you will end up writing a GS answer like a general studies paper 1 or paper 2. So sociology substance which is very much packed in the current affairs is what is my thing which I am selecting, right? Now coming to demonetization and digitalization discourse. How this demonetization and digitalization will have to be seen in the light of the social consequences or the social impact. History tells you that always profound economic ideas had a very big impact on the society. All economic ideas which are very much profound, they have a very strong impact in the society. The members of the society, they are looking at the nature of the social change through this ideas which are economic ideas. So any question on economic ideas, you have to link this thing with Karl Marx. Marxism, Durkheim, Parsons, these three persons, these three sociologists, they have dealt on the subject called as capitalism. So exclusion is caused because of the capitalist paradigm of growth which we have embarked on. One such initiative is digitalization initiative. So we have to see this demonetization or digitalization drive as a new way of politics which is wanting to redefine the relation between the state and the citizen. Before, when we introduced capitalism in 1990 economic reforms, that we were keeping the common man in the center. Always the government in power will keep the common man in the center and they'll draft a policy. At the same time, what happens in the name of the poor, if a policy is implemented, then it is only catering to the interests of the bourgeois, is what is Marxism. So you have to look at this demonetization through Marxian perspective. The assumption of the state when it is going for demonetization is that there is only formalized economy present. But we see that there is so much of informal economy present, and this informal economy is crushed because of this policy called demonetization or digitalization drive. A number of reports are there which indicates how there is so much of unequal access of the banking services today. There is existing a regional difference, say the poor, the rich versus the poor difference, or the urban versus the rural difference, men versus women difference. So much of digital divide is present across areas, across gender, across class, across caste. But without taking into account of this type of digital divide, when a policy is implemented, then that is resulting in the growth of the formal corporate sector at the cost of the informal sector. So this is the substance of demonetization and its sociological impact. We said that dominant economic ideas always have a profound impact on the society at various levels, whether it is economic level or it is political level or it is cultural level or it is familial level. So there is a deep societal impact caused by all dominant economic ideas, and one dominant economic idea is demonetization. A new moral economy they are wanting to construct through this demonetization. However, more than demonetization, the present time we wanted to address to the developmental issues which the country faces today. There is so much of discrimination, there is so much of inequality, there is so much of poverty, illiteracy, and the erosion of the government institutions. The legitimacy of the institutions are eroding. Agrarian unrest is present. Tribal problems are present. Women are subjected to multiple types of exploitation. Rural landlessness is present. Farmer suicide is present. So there are so much of developmental challenges which India is facing. And in this context, now demonetization is introduced. Those who support the digitalization, they perceive that If you don't have vegetable in your meal, then Food Panda application will be the solution. And they are also measuring the intergenerational learning through what? How far you are able to use ATM card, how far you are able to use internet transactions. So, intergenerational learning is seen as a learning with respect to digitalization, but actually speaking, digitalization has nothing to do with intergenerational learning. We told that through this demonetization, there is a new relationship which the government is trying to establish between the citizens and the state. The drive of demonetization thinks that corruption and black money is only a product of institutional problems. But we have seen that corruption or black money is not mainly because of institutional problems, it is because of unethical individual behavior. Demonetization or digitalization is not going to stop this unethical behavior, which is only leading to corruption. So, earlier in 1990, the government was keeping the common man in the center and they drafted LPG model. Now, the same logic the government is following, for the sake of the common man, for the sake of the poor people, they have gone for demonetization. But later only we come to know that demonetization has only produced more ill effects on the common man. So, now that the common man is becoming a center stage player in the politics. Economic liberalization was made in the name of the poor, but actually it only benefited the rich corporate formal sectors. And when we look at deeply, what is the main aspect, the dimension of demonetization? It is only addressing to one problem present in economy, that is the problem of exchange. It is not looking at the structural reasons for the economic crisis. So, there is no structural analysis of the economic problems, rather it is only treating economic problem as rooted in the means of exchange, or it is in the exchange terms. Debate is only on the exchange. No structural or production issues were discussed in this demonetization. The exclusion which is present, that World Bank Global Findex data, it says that only 4% of total wage recipients are using a bank account to get their wages. So, this is the data of 2014 released by World Bank Global Findex data. Only 4% of the wage recipients are using a bank account to receive their wages in 2014. So, just 4% of people are using their bank accounts to receive the wages. In case of rural area, how much percentage of people are using bank accounts to get their wage? It is less than 3%. Only 2.96% of people in the rural area, they are getting the wages through bank accounts. So, banks are not accessible to the common man. This is what the inference which you can draw from the data. Among the 40% of poorest household, only 1.7% of the adults use bank account to receive their wages. So, there is no financial inclusion, there is no inclusion of poor or the common man into the financial system, banking services. When everything will have to happen through banks, when demonetization wanted, everything will have to happen through banks, then we find that this is the biggest problem, that the access of banks is not present for the common man living in the rural area. So, 40% of the poor household, out of which only 1.7% of the adult members of these poor households, they take wages from the bank accounts, through the bank accounts. So, we have a false imagination about financial access. There is a false imagination about the financial access. So, like false class consciousness. There is only a false imagination about the financial access. So poor man thinks that if he is able to transact through internet, if he is able to use ATM card, then he has become rich. So this is only creating a false class consciousness. There is a survey, Financial Inclusion Insight Survey, which gives this picture. Only 10% of the adult members, adult male members, were aware of the concept called, there is something called mobile money. Only 10% of the adults are aware of the concept of mobile money, and look at the usage, it is just 0.5% of the adults are using this mobile money. We have seen 2011 says 26% of people are illiterate, and definitely language becomes a barrier in the interaction. When you are making a electronic exchange, then definitely language becomes one of the biggest barrier. 26% of people are illiterate, and language becomes one of the important hurdle in digitalization. So poor are not able to get integrated into the digital world because of the English language, which is what is needed for the internet transaction. Census data 2011 also says 58.7% of the total households, they access banking services. But however, across gender and the rural urban, there is a digital divide. Look at this. In case of urban India, 67% of people, of households, are using the banking services, whereas in rural area 54% of people are using banking services, which means only 50% of the people present in the rural area, they are able to get connected to bank accounts, according to this census 2011. 3.2% of the females and 18% of the male are using debit card. So women are excluded from digital transaction because only 3% of women are using the ATM card, whereas 18% of men are using ATM card. So we have seen how there is a digital divide across regions, rural versus urban, across gender, men versus women. There is one famous author whose book came in the news, Kenneth Rogoff. He is writing a book titled The Curse of Cash. In this book, he is explaining that when most of the people are not included in the banking services, it is not wise to introduce demonetization. Demonetization will have to be introduced only when people are integrated into the banking services. So he says it will only cause more good for the corporate world rather than for the small or the micro sector or the agricultural communities. Large sections of population don't have access to banking services. So it is only promoting the corporate sector at the expense of the informal sector. It is only promoting corporate sector at the expense of the informal sector. Look at what the Union Budget 2015 says, that the corporate tax will be reduced from 30% to 20% in next 4 years is what the Union Budget 2015 says. So this also will benefit only the corporate sector. So keep this Marxian perspective in your mind and read the data so that you will be able to include these datas when they are asking about the relevance of Marxism in Indian society. There is a sure shot question which is going to come this time in Marx because of the 150th year of Das Kapital. So formal sector will only get benefited, and definitely we have seen that it negatively impacted agriculture. People, agrarian community is not having any institutional credit system. They are very much excluded from the institutional credit system. They are more banking on the informal transaction. So the input cost of agriculture started escalating. People were not able to avail the informal credit system, and this is why there was so much of hue and cry in the farming community after demonetization was announced. It negatively impacts agriculture. The input cost of agriculture increased. Money is not there with the farmer. He cannot sow the seeds, he cannot buy the agricultural input, he will not be able to take cash from some money lender. So all these things got disturbed because of demonetization. So understood, what is sociology of demonetization? That you are writing from Marxian perspective, demonetization, to speak about how there is no proper access to the financial system or the institutional financial system for the poor people, right? All initiatives made in the name of the poor is only catering to the rich, is what the bottom line of the story of demonetization. Hundreds of people died, hundreds of persons died by waiting in the queue. The second topic which we need to take up is silicosis case. A Supreme Court judgment came, and this judgment very clearly says it is the onus of the state government to ensure the health aspect of the workers. So it is the onus of the state, because there is a directive principle which very clearly says that you have to take care of the health and strength of the workers, Article 39 says. So the court has given a judgment. Definitely the judgment is very important, because there is a topic called as the informal sector or informalization of work, or there is a topic called as migration in your sociology. You can use the input in these two areas, informalization of work. Paper 1, 6th unit, if you see that there is a topic economy and society, where you see informalization of work, you can add this. Then in paper 2, you have migration. You have migration. There also you can use the input. Silicosis, the many people, many villagers, in fact more than 100 villages were affected by this disease. People living in more than 100 villages in the western UP, they were affected by this disease because of inhaling silica, which is very, very toxic. So more than 200 people died in the recent time, and 1700 people died in the last 10 years. And you can also see most of the victims are in the age group of 19 to 30 or 35. So the government or the insurance agencies are not giving the compensation, which is why the struggle of the workers working in the silica industry was a very long problem happening, and the court has given a proper solution for their problem by giving the state the onus to protect the health and strength of the workers. Right? Occupational health hazard. There is more occupational health hazard, that the workers are unorganized workers. If they are organized workers, definitely they will have a trade union. So they will be able to articulate their problem very effectively, and the state would listen to the problem of the organized workers. But unorganized workers, they have to die a death when they are exposed to occupational diseases like silicosis. Most of the workers are workers, migrant workers who are affected by this disease. Migrant workers were affected by this disease in the western Madhya Pradesh. So the court has told state is accountable for safety of the workers, that they have to ensure that there is a humane working condition as what is instructed by the instruments of instruction or the directive principles, Article 42. ESI acted as an anti-worker organization because of the cumbersome procedures. So many were not able to get the insurance coverage, and the poor diseased worker is at the mercy of the owner. So most of the time the poor worker will have to go back to his village and die quickly or die quietly there. So the problem is not coming to the center stage itself, because of they have no organizing potential. So power of the organized masses, power of the unorganized masses, you have to use Weberian theory. I have even put a question in your test series, organized power and unorganized power. Unorganized power, people are not able to, you know, they are not able to influence the government, they cannot articulate their interest if they are unorganized. So unorganized workers who are migrant workers, they are worst hit because of the pollution or the environmental hazard. 238 workers died so far in the last year itself, and this is a place, western Madhya Pradesh is a place, hilly place, where tribal people, vulnerable tribal people are living. So most of the victims of this occupational disease is who? Tribal people. Problems of the tribes, there is one topic in your paper too, you can use this thing. So there was no preventive mechanism to help the people. They are inhaling silica sand, which is very toxic. A toxic chemical is inhaled. Crushed silica sand, if inhaled, is a toxic chemical, and by inhaling this crushed silica sand only, they are getting the silicosis disease. So there is no treatment for this disease at all. As a result of it, the poor migrant tribal worker will have to die. 1 or 2 years, if he catches the disease, in 1 or 2 years, death is inevitable. But silica is adding on to the wealth of the rich owners. It is devastating the health of the workers. So all the profits through the silica manufacturing is going to the owner, but the worker will have to die because of silicosis. Marx predicted that the owner will pocket all the wealth, all the burden will have to be transferred to the head of the proletariat. So he is right. More than 100 villages were affected by this deadly disease. 1700 people have died in the last 10 years who are in the age group of 19 to 35. So much of demographically stronger age group. It should be converted into a demographic dividend, but actually what is happening is this is converted into a demographic disaster, devastation to the demographic dividend, turning it into a demographic disaster. In some cases, some villages, male population itself is getting eroded, so it is also disturbing the demographic profile of the village. There is a survey, Destined to Die 2016, which says that many of the workers who were affected by silicosis, their name is not found in the employer list of the company. They are very temporary workers. Even their name is not there in the record of the company. So because of this only, they are not able to claim any compensation, right? So they are not permanent workers, they are temporary, they are not, their name is not even included in the book of the company. And this is known through this survey, Destined to Die 2016, a survey conducted which reveals that most of the patients of silicosis, their name itself is not there in the book of the companies. Because they are unorganized workers, they have no bargaining power. The third topic is dependency of Indian women in US. H1B visa mostly benefited the Indian workers. But a study of the gender perspective of H1B visa reveals that H1B visa is given to workers, Indian workers, in sectors which are dominated by men. So there is a H4 visa which is given for the dependents of H1B visa holders. Most of the time, the professional is taking his wife to US. Even though his wife is highly educated, but since she is bearing this H4 visa, she is not supposed to take even a license, driving license, or not even able to take an employment benefit in the outside market without the approval of her husband. So she is subjected to isolation. She cannot come search a job in the market without the sanction of her husband. She will not be able to get any entitlement card without the sanction of the husband. She will not be able to get even a driving license without the sanction of her husband, and she is subjected to all types of, you know, isolation. So she feels that she becomes worthless. Her attitude towards herself and her educational qualification is also eroding too much, that she is like the poor worker in the theory of Karl Marx. So she is having a state of pauperization, right? So which means that there is one topic in your fifth unit, social stratification, class based society, class based stratification and the functionalist theory of stratification. That stratification is functional is what Parsons says, Davis and Moore says. And there is also a topic, open society, closed society debate, that if you go to America, everything is open. But you see that the migrant population, those who are coming under the H4 or H1B visa, they are subjected to so much of discrimination in America. So who says America is a meritocratic society? Parsons is wrong. Davis and Moore is wrong. That America is an open society which allows mobility for all irrespective of the ethnic identity is wrong. There is a gender based discrimination faced by women, Indian women who go to US along with her spouse, right? So gender as the basis of stratification you have in paper 1, problem of women you have in paper 2, patriarchy and sexual division of labor you have in paper 1 as well as paper 2. So you can write this topic in any of the topics which they are asking in your examination, right? So gender based stratification, patriarchy and sexual division of labor, women's movement, open society, closed society debate, these are the topics. If they ask a question on these topics, you can write this thing as a current affairs substance, the dependent Indian women in US. It only perpetuates overt focus on male workforce. So gender based discrimination, how it is only catering to male dominated sectors. H1B visa is dominating, is only catering to the male dominating sectors. H4 visa disempowered the dependents. H4 visa is disempowering the dependents. So women going to US under this H4 visa is excluded from the labor market. Her financial and legal status is tied to her spouse. So we said she cannot start a bank account, she cannot get her driving license, she cannot get a social protection card. So she has to confine herself to four walls of the house. She is highly qualified and now she is having a self doubt. She is reared by the society that you have to accept only the authority of the men, and she is subjected to isolation, frustration, and she is more and more becoming like a proletariate, right? Loss of identity, complete dependence, lack of confidence, forced employment. These are the problems faced by women because of this H1B visa. Loss of identity, complete dependence on the spouse, husband, lack of confidence, forced unemployment. So what is more troublesome is she is unemployed even though she is highly qualified. Since she is unemployed, she is going to take up only the domestic role. The culturally stereotypical role is enforced by the society on women. So she has to do unpaid domestic works. Now this is causing so much of self doubt and she is not going to have any type of intellectual interaction with the outside society. So she is confining to the four walls of the house. She is not having any avenue to interact intellectually with the outside society, and she is always living in an utter sense of dependency, right? What feminist scholars have told, capitalism made women economically dependent on men. So modernity is not meaning women empowerment, modernity is only leading to more subjugation of women, because modernity itself is the construct of patriarchy. So this is the design of patriarchy, that even if they are going to US, there also they have to do the household job. They cannot go and interact with the outside world. intellectually. Oxfam report on inequality. The topic which you can link with this issue is capitalism, Karl Marx, Emile Durkheim, again Parsons, again fifth unit social stratification, right? Oxfam report, bottom 50% of the world population has only 0.2% of the world's wealth. So this also can be included in your 10th unit, development and dependency. Bottom 50% is able to access only 0.2% of the world's wealth. Top 8 billionaires, they have wealth more than the 50% of the population, more than the bottom 50% of the population. And this famous book, Capital in 21st Century, explains the how inequality is increasing because of capitalism. The dynamics of capitalism causing inequality is brilliantly explained by Thomas Piketty in his book, Capital in 21st Century. So he explains the dynamics of growing inequality in developed capitalist societies. Add this thing to your Marx or social stratification or development and dependency. These are the three topics which you can link this data to paper on sociology. Thomas Piketty will have to be written when Marxism is asked. Look at the growth in income of the bottom 50%, it is just zero. Bottom 50% income growth is zero, whereas the income of the top 1% has grown by 300%. And you can also see that the CEO of a top information firm of India is getting 416 times more salary than a typical employee of the company. What is the salary of the employee of his company, a very typical employee of the company? This 416 times more the CEO is earning. So there is so much of inequality. Marx predicted that those who own they control, those who control they use to exploit the poor, they become rich, rich becomes richer, poor becomes poorer. Bill Gates' wealth is increasing, it increased 50%, or he increases wealth by $25 billion since he left Microsoft. So you still own some shares of the company. You are owning the instruments, financial instruments of the company, as a result of which, even when he is walking out of the company, he is able to increase his wealth. He added his wealth by $25 billion since 2006. And ownership is very, very instrumental in distribution, Karl Marx told. Ownership of assets. Ownership of income yielding asset. So income from property is more than income from wage. This is what Marxism says, that if you are owner, by virtue of your ownership you will be able to earn more money. So income from property is more than income from wage, which means property ownership is very much crucial for your, you know, access to the economic benefits. Income from property is overwhelmingly concentrated at the top of the income scale. Through the history of capitalism, you come to know that the top 1% will always stand apart. They will not be influenced by any depression, nothing will hurt them. So they are becoming a class apart. The top 1% will not be affected by any type of depression. And they have become the normal in the history of capitalism. The top 1% becomes the normal in the history of capitalism. They are untouched by any problem of the system. Look at the problem that on one hand economic inequality is increasing. On the other hand, there is a stagnation in the economy. That there will be present unemployment problem, there will be present underemployment problem, and there will not be any proper utilization of the capacity. So stagnation plus rising inequality, this is going to hit the workers more. One hand there is stagnation, on the other hand rising inequality. So it will definitely cause more burden to the poor. Stagnation plus increasing inequality. Stagnation can be measured in terms of economy will grow very slowly. Demonetization resulted in what? The economy fell by 2 to 3%, right? Economy fell by 2 to 3%, and who are hit? All the small scale industry people, they are hit because they don't have any institutional system of transaction. And how the companies are able to influence the government today? They are only influencing government more than the voter. How? They will buy the bonds of the government, thereby they will be influencing the government. So by providing cheap credit facility to the government, the corporates and the big companies, they are going to influence the government more than the voters. Institutions buy government bonds and influence the government policies more than any electorate. So this situation is called as plutocracy, it is not a democracy. And also you can see the north-south divide is also becoming very deep. After capitalism becomes matured, that the north-south divide, north nations versus south nation, north nations they reflect, they represent capitalism, and the south nation they represent the developing economies. There is an increasing gap between the global north and the global south. In the global south, millions of people will become disillusioned because of capitalism. That they will be worst hit because of the slums which will happen in capitalism periodically. And in the developing country, there is present what? Caste based inequality, race based inequality, patriarchy, imperialism. So there is so much of overlap of all types of inequality in the south or the developing economies, including India. Overlapping of multiple inequalities in the global south, especially the developing economies like India. Already there is present imperialism, MNCs are controlling, all types of inequalities are present, caste based inequality, race based inequality, religion based inequality. So this is going to cause more problems. Millions of dispossessed people are suffering in the southern countries, say the developing countries. And these people become what? They become the reserve army of labor. So capitalism develops recession to ensure that there is a consistent supply of cheap labor force through the creation of reserve army of labor. Now Dalits are not homogeneous, Dalits are heterogeneous. There is a caste within caste. So we have in sociology class within caste, caste within class. We are going to speak about caste within caste. Why Dalit mobilization is not that much present like in other, unlike other places? Why Dalit mobilization is not really happening in Punjab, even though Punjab is the state having more than 30% of the total population who are Dalits? Why? Because within the Dalits there is present a caste like hierarchy. Like Varna system is present, there is a caste based hierarchy within Dalits. So there is more fragmentation of the Dalits, as a result of which they are not able to become a political force to be reckoned with, right? So this is what is the thing which we are going to see, that Dalits are not homogeneous and Dalit consciousness is not emerging in Punjab because of the fragmentation of Dalits. There are 39 castes which are coming under Dalits. So Dalits are divided into 39 castes. there is a heterogeneity, caste heterogeneity, which is preventing their upward mobility as well as political mobility. Neither they are not able to become political force, nor they are able to experience any type of upward mobility because of the cleavages within themselves. More than 31% of the total population is Dalit population in Punjab. And there are more than 57 villages are having 100% of Dalit population. But based on religion, they are divided. Based on subcaste, they are divided, which is why they are not able to emerge as a revolutionary force. In case of Punjab, Brahmanism is very weak because of two things. One is Islamization as well as Sikhism. Due to Islam and Sikh faith, weak Brahmanism in Punjab. So you have the Dalits who are beyond the Varna system. They are called as Avarnas, and they are also called as Adi Shudras. They are untouchables. They are not coming within the four Varna, they are outside the four Varna and they are untouchables. So they do unclean jobs, polluting jobs. Now bring who? Louis Dumond. You bring Louis Dumond. When you write about Louis Dumond, Homo Hierarchicus, he says that caste is a homogeneous group. He is wrong. Caste is not a homogeneous group. Within the caste, there is present so much of heterogeneity. Dalits are divided into 39 castes. So you cannot say that Dalits, they emerge as one single force in all the states and they will be able to seize the political power. This is not possible because of the heterogeneity within the Dalit sections, especially in Punjab. They do unclean jobs. Because of the heterogeneous hierarchy within the Dalit sections, they are not able to successfully convert this strength into a political mileage. They are not able to become politically successful. Republican Party of India, Scheduled Caste Federation, BSP, they are poorly performing in Punjab, even though these parties are, you know, banking on the Dalit votes. They are Dalit based parties, but they are not able to successfully mobilize people politically because of the cleavages within the Dalit sections. So Dalits are divided by the same logic of hierarchy, like the caste system, caste based social cleavages. And because of the social cleavages, they fight within themselves. There is a social conflict which is resulting into fractured Dalit consolidation. Dalit consolidation is fractured because of the rivalry within the 39 castes present in the Dalit community. Caste within caste. Look at some castes like Rai Sikhs, Ramdasiyas, they practice this Sikhism, and Balmikis, they are Hindus, and there is a group Adi Dharmis or Ravidasis. They are all creating their own religion called as Dalit religion. So religious distinctions are there. Politically also they are affiliated to different parties. Chamars and Balmikis, they are affiliated to Congress party, whereas the others, Rai Sikhs, Sansis, they are affiliated to Akali Dal. So politically they are fragmented, religiously they are fragmented, right? Which is why they are not able to emerge as a single force, political force or social force. So much of differences within themselves. Castes are present within the caste. Not only within caste there is present class, not only within class there is present caste, within the caste there are present many castes, right? So there are sweeper caste, they all form a cluster, caste cluster, caste grade. Edmund Leach is using the term caste grade or caste cluster. all the related caste will come together, they will try to mobilize politically, socially. So related caste groups will come together, they will come under the same umbrella and they will try to mobilize themselves as a political force and demand something from the state. So there are many clusters within Dalit community, there are present many clusters like Chura caste cluster, Chamar caste cluster, Vimukta Jatis caste cluster and the peripheral caste cluster. So within Dalits there are present many caste clusters, which is why they are not able to become a homogeneous group. And this division among the Dalit community, intra-Dalit community division, is also exploited by the political parties. Mainstream political parties are trying to divide deeply divide the divisions which are already present within the Dalit communities for political reasons, which is why there is no Dalit consciousness. Dalit consciousness is not happening because of caste heterogeneity and sharp cleavages. So they suffer from discrimination like caste system, upper caste discriminates the lower caste. Within the lower caste, within the untouchable, there is also present discrimination. So it is not an all India hierarchy which you can establish, which you can perceive from the perspective of Louis Dumont. He says entire caste is seen as a hierarchy. So each group present within the caste system or hierarchy, they are homogeneous, they are not homogeneous. Within them there is present divisions. This is explained by who? Which Indian sociologist says caste is not homogeneous, Brahmins are heterogeneous? Andre Bethe, in his work Caste Class Power, a study in Sripuram village, explains how Brahmins are not homogeneous, Brahmins are heterogeneous. So this is something which you can add to speak about the relevance of Andre Bethe and criticize Louis Dumont. Now look at the how there is a erroneous notion about Muslims in India. So there is a stereotype. The stereotype says Muslims, they are increasing their numbers more than Hindus, right? And the myth says they are opposing family planning. Another myth says that they have highest fertility. But all these commonsensical understanding which is propagated by sectarian group is fault. They are wrong generalizations. Data clearly indicate in comparison to Hindu, their population is increasing, but in comparison to the previous decade, their population is declining, the growth rate of population is declining. And studies also have found out that Muslims are not against family planning, Muslims are not polygamous. So the ill-conceived notion is spread by sectarian groups to divide India on community lines, to create a cultural nationalism, to create Hindutva. They are trying to propagate this ill-conceived notion. The idea or the fact which you have to know from this topic is that the problems of religious minorities are basically flowing from the ill-conceived notion about religious minority by the majority. There was a question asked in 2016, means majoritarianism versus minoritarianism. You can add these points to those things, right? Falsification of reality is normalized. There is a normalization of falsification of reality, normalizing the falsification of reality. There is a falsification of reality which becomes the normal. Amartya Sen says, using single identity, say religious identity, you can easily divide people between by creating a sense of we versus they. So religious identity is a very strong divider. It can divide easily people, Amartya Sen says. There was a question in sociology 2015 or 16. The question is, how far religion can be an identity to create a nation? Is religion providing sufficient identity to consolidate the groups? Now, religion consolidation of people, you have to think about who? Emile Durkheim. Durkheim says religion unifies people. Marx says religion is only opium of the masses. Weber says religion will rationalize you. Parsons says religion will give you meaning for your life. All these people spoke about religion. Now, what actually religion does? Religion is dividing people. R.K. Merton told that in a heterogeneous society, religion will divide people. Amartya Sen says religious identity is a singular marker for constructing an us versus them debate. So, religious identity is a very significant marker which can divide people into two groups and create a sense of feeling that we are different from they. Religious identity as a singular marker for constructing an us versus them debate, says Amartya Sen. We are using demography for political objective, non-demographic objective. A term which is used by Jeffrey is saffron demography. Saffron demography or sectarian demography, a term used by Shahid. Saffron demography, sectarian demography, using demography to divide people. These are the myths. Muslims are outnumbering Hindus is a myth. Look at the fact. Decadal growth rate of Muslim is 24% in 2011, 29.5% in 2001. In terms of proportion of population, Hindus, they declined by 0.7%. In proportion of population, Muslims increased by 0.8%. So, Hindu population is reducing by 0.7%. Muslim population is increasing by 0.8%. This also came in the newspapers that Hindus are declining, Muslims are increasing. But however, you should not compare Hindus with Muslims. You should compare Muslims in 2001 with Muslims in 2011. So, from 13.4% Muslims increased to 14.2% of the total population. But if you see 2001 to 2011, increase in Muslim population is just a 0.8%. 1991 to 2001, increase in Muslim population was 1.7%. So, when you compare 1991 to 2001, 2001 to 2011, you see that Muslim population increase is only reducing. Right? 11, 1 to 11, it is increasing by 0.8. 99 to 2001, it increased by 1.7. So, more than 50% of fall in the Muslim population, if you compare 1991 data, 2001 to 2011 data. But what was projected is Hindus are declining by 0.7%, Muslims are increasing by 0.8%. Over a period of time, Muslims will become majority. So, this is a myth, and this myth is created because of the sectarian groups who wanted to construct nation based on religion. Jeffrey in their study in Bijnor in UP, in their study of Bijnor in UP, found that Muslim fertility declined by 1.3% against 0.6% for Hindus. So, 1992 to 2006, fertility of Muslims declined, whereas fertility of Hindus increased. So it is not that Muslims, they have high fertility. In UP study, Jeffrey found Hindus' fertility is more than the Muslims' fertility. And this also was a common sense that Muslims practice polygamy, but Indian Muslims are practicing only monogamy. Polygamy is more present only in the tribal population. More polygamy only in tribes, not in Muslims. And third myth is they are against family planning. Khan's study found that they are not against family planning. They practice family planning in a study of Kanpur city. Khan found family planning is not rejected by Muslims. They also adopt family planning. Now the next topic is how we have seen there is a caste-based hierarchy present within the Dalits in Punjab. There is a caste-based hierarchy present within the Muslims. Caste among non-Hindus was the question which was asked in one of our test batch questions. In one of the test batch questions, I have put a question that caste among non-Hindus. The perception is that caste is only a feature of Hindu society. Caste is not just a feature of Hindu society, caste is also a feature of non-Hindu society. There is a study by Prashant K. Trivedi, untouchability practiced among the Muslims in 14 districts of UP. So there is a topic called untouchability, there is a topic called as problems of religious minority, there is a topic called caste system in your paper 2. In these three places you can write this substance. Trivedi studies untouchability among Muslims, so it is not just a Hindu phenomena. That is why religious conversion is not going to improve the life of people. Neither Islamization was complete that people are relieved from the caste based hierarchy, nor Islamization resulted in the political or social upliftment or educational upliftment of the people who got converted. So the problem of conversion is that it is not substantially improving the position of the people. And Louis Dumont rightly pointed out that any attempt to change your caste based discrimination is only leading to substantialization of caste. He is rejecting Sanskritization. Any attempt to mobility within the caste system is only leading to substantialization of caste. So he is right. Islam textually says it is against caste system, but it practices caste system. There are two types of Muslims: Ashraf Muslims who are pure and of foreign blood, Ajlav Muslims who are impure and they are Hindu converts. So Ajlav Muslims are untouchables. Ajlav Muslims are untouchable. Ashraf Muslims practice untouchability against the Ajlav Muslims. So caste is not just a feature of Hindu society or Hindu social organization. Right? Ajlavs are untouchables. Neither complete Islamization helped them, nor conversion resulted in socio-economic progress. So conversion is no solution for discrimination, is what the conclusion. Neither they were completely Islamized nor conversion helped them to get mobility. So old inequality is replaced by new inequality. Wilson studies this thing also, that many Mahars who converted to Buddhism, their position did not improve. Wilson study. Dalit Muslims practice untouchability. Questions are asked on Dr. Ambedkar, on Mahatma Gandhi. Last year also you had a question. Before that also you had a question. What Dr. Ambedkar speaks on water democracy? He says that irrespective of caste, class, gender, region, people should have free access to water. So, Dr. Ambedkar is giving a solution for Kaveri water dispute. All the water disputes which are present today, interstate water dispute present today, is warranting a solution. And the solution comes from Dr. Ambedkar. He says, like political democracy, social democracy, economic democracy, there is something called as water democracy, that everybody should access water. In 1927, in the Mahad Satyagraha, he was emphasizing this need for access to water. One should break the geographical, caste, class barriers to access water. Right? Regionalism. There is a question on regionalism. When we discussed regionalism, we said that interstate river water dispute also strengthens this regionalism. It strengthens regionalism. Sharing of the resources leading to regional divisions. So, when regionalism is asked and they are asking you some solutions for regionalism, then you can quote Dr. Ambedkar on water democracy, speaks about how water should be accessed by all irrespective of geographical or primordial identities. He also spoke about Dalit capitalism, that there is so much of distress in agriculture, the vicious cycle of agriculture can be broken only when you go for industries. So, industrialization is a solution to break this vicious cycle present in agriculture. He spoke about Dalit capitalism, that Dalits should not wait for the state-sponsored benefits to uplift them. Dalits will have to jump into industries and they have to ensure that the free market is able to provide them opportunity for mobility, which they cannot search through government policies. But our studies indicated that who are capitalists? Most of the Dalit capitalists are present only in the polluting industries like meat industry. They are not present in the food industry. Dalit capitalism. He wanted restructuring of the villages. So, village, there is a topic called village studies, the problems of Indian villages. In that, you can quote Dr. Ambedkar. He spoke about how there should be political, socialist, economic restructuring of the villages. He also, like Karl Marx, wanted abolition of ownership of the land. Abolition of land ownership. He wanted nationalization of land and abolition of land ownership. So, he is following Marxian ideology. So, there is a topic called social challenges to social transformation. There is a topic in your section C of paper 2, 7th topic, challenges to social transformation, where they have spoken about the problems of development and the problem of sustainable development, displacement. Big dams are big problems for the poor, Dr. Ambedkar says. He was not happy with civil society. There is a question, oftly repeated question in your main examination sociology, civil society and democracy. Dr. Ambedkar is saying civil society is dominated by Brahmins. So, he wanted civil society should be replaced by popular movements. There is also a topic called social movement. So, you can use Dr. Ambedkar in topics like regionalism, caste system, villages, problems of sustainable development and social movements, protests. He wanted popular movements or people's movement as a counter to hegemonistic civil society. Civil society is controlled by Brahmins, so it is hegemonistic civil society. Civil society is undemocratic. That is why he has to he says replace civil society by popular movement. Regional discrimination is also a social discrimination, according to Dr. Ambedkar. Now, speaking about violence against women, there is a topic called as violence against women in your paper 2. There is also a topic called as patriarchy in paper 1. Patriarchy, gender as the base of stratification, women's movement, violence against women. These are the four topics. I have told two topics in paper 1, two topics in paper 2. You can write this fact in any of the question which is on gender injustice or violence against women. In conflict zones, women are targeted. We also know that during the communal conflict in India, which resulted in separation of Pakistan, more than 1 lakh women were sexually assaulted. So, women's body is a place to demonstrate nationalism. It is not because of the uncontrolled impulses of men, but because of orders that systematically women are targeted. Women were held as sex slaves by Japan in 1930s. So, how women are subjected to sexual violence in the conflict zones, whether it is in Sri Lanka or it is in the communal tensions. You have seen communal violence Gujarat 2002, you have seen Mumbai riot 1992, and we have seen the liberation of Bangladesh 1971 and the communal conflict during 1940s resulting in the separation of Pakistan. In all these sectarian violence, we have women becoming the victims of this sectarian violence. So, it is becoming a strategy of war, tactic of war, not just rape out of control, but rape under orders. So, it is a means to pursue political, economic or military ends. Violence against women is a means to secure political, economic or military ends. There were comfort stations which were established by Japanese in 1932, where women were kept as sex slaves. No tribunal, Tokyo tribunal was constituted to study the war crimes, but the Tokyo tribunal deliberately did not take up the issues like sex slaves or the comfort zones which were created by the Japanese military. So, in all the conflict ridden areas, in the conflict zones, what is very obvious is sexual violence unleashed systematically against women. Women as sex slaves, patriarchy. So, there are many problems like rape, sexual slavery, forced prostitution, forced pregnancy, enforced sterilization. These are the problems faced by women, violence faced by women. Women who are the victims of sexual violence, they don't go and report because it is stigmatized, right? Because of the societal, cultural, religious reasons, there is under reporting of sexual violence or non-reporting of the sexual violence. There is a stigma for the victims. Sexual violence victims are stigmatized by the society. Land right movement in Guwahati, that encroachment was made by the rich people and the government, which became legitimized, whereas encroachment which was made by poor people, they were called as you are encroacher, and they were thrown out of their own land. Just because they are not having the land record, they are thrown out of their own land in Guwahati. So, displacement, encroachment on wetland and hills, conflict about housing rights, poor become the victim of eviction drives, and encroachment made by the state and the high income group is becoming legitimized, and this results in violence in Guwahati. So, problems of displacement you have in section C, 7th unit of paper 2, there is a topic called as problems of displacement, displacement and development. You can write here, write this thing in that area. Encroachments on the wetland, conflict about housing rights, the poor were thrown out, the rich, their encroachment becomes legal, and this is what is leading to violence and counter violence. Gender based discrimination in Punjab, even though most significant, you know, achievement took place in Punjab in terms of child sex ratio, but however still discrimination continues. Despite of the remarkable improvement in CSR, there is still gender based discrimination continuing in Punjab. It is a rich state but not developed state, so it is a paradox. Improvement in CSR, but there is so much of gender based discrimination in health care, immunization, nutrition between the boy and the girl. Gender based discrimination in the health sector. Look at the data. National Family Health Survey 3, 2005-2006 data, 64.7% of male children and 53% of female children received full immunization coverage. So, only half of girl children are getting the full immunization coverage. Similarly, when people are taken to doctor, 82% of the male child, 65% of the female child are taken to the doctor when they get fever. So, which means if a girl child gets fever, she is not taken to the doctor. When a boy child is getting fever, then he will be taken to the doctor. There is a gender based discrimination in the access of health services in Punjab, despite of the fact that Punjab is significantly improving its child sex ratio. So, this is the data which you can get from National Family Health Survey 3 for the year 2005-2006. There is a question, every year they ask a question on the coexistence of tradition and modern. Eisenstadt, he speaks about how there is multiple modernity, theory of multiple modernity is given by Eisenstadt. He says that Western modernity is totally different from the non-Western modernity. In non-Western modernity, they choose the elements of modern and they mix that with the elements of tradition based on the socio-cultural context. Non-Western societies, in non-Western societies, components of modernity with a local context without giving up culture, without giving up certain cultural elements, they have gone for a synthetic modernity. Deepankar Gupta calls mistaken modernity. So, West and East, they are two different projects. Indian modernity is not European modernity. Modern and tradition, they form a continuum, they interact with each other. So, modernity is not westernization, and modernity is not, Western modernity is not authentic modernity. Modernity is different from westernization. Western modernity is not authentic modernity. Sudipto Kaviraj writes a book, Modernity and Politics in India. He says modern practices are situated in historical and social context. So, he says modernity is not written on the clean slate. It is not written on the clean slate. Modernity is practiced as per your own history and culture. So, there is an interaction between these two, modernity and tradition. 100% question will come on modernity and tradition. Write about Eisenstadt in his theory of multiple modernities. There is a coexistence of modern and tradition in the micro and the macro system or structure. So they interact, they don't displace each other, they interact with each other. Kaviraj is writing how English medium schools were earlier accessed only by the rich people, but now it is accessed even by middle class, right? So modernity is making appearance in education system. English education is only the preserve of Brahmins before, it is the preserve of the rich class before. Upper caste and the upper class only can access English education, but today English education is accessed by middle class and to some extent even to the lower class. So there is a change which he is seeing, but there is also a coexistence of Brahminic education with the secular education. Brahminic education gives more importance to memorizing. Scientific education gives more importance to analyzing. In the contemporary education system, you have both memorizing as well as analyzing, is an example of the coexistence of modernity and tradition. Brahminic education gives importance to memorizing. Scientific education gives importance to analyzing. There is a coexistence today that there is both modernizing as well as traditional education, that analyzing plus memorizing becomes a part and parcel of the modern education system today. So coexistence. Next topic is education and women empowerment. The question is education an instrument of social change? So 10th unit of paper 1, social change, education and social change. Three times last 3 years continuously a question was asked on education as an instrument of social change. There is also a topic in your paper 2, illiteracy and disparity in education. You can add this thing in education and social change plus illiteracy and disparity in education paper 2. Look at the literacy level increases which you know. What education means for women? It is a means to access resources. When you get educated, you can access resources, social as well as material. You can alter the social inequality, self-reliance, and you can contest the patriarchy. So what education can do for social change, what education can do for women empowerment is what we are discussing. It can change the patriarchal ideology. It can also give access to material as well as social resources for women. On one hand, it can transform the unequal structure. At the same time, it can reinforce the unequal structure. It can also reinforce the patriarchal socio-cultural mores. It can transform as well as it can reinforce the present inequality. What is the impact of education? Definitely it raises the age of marriage of educated women, especially in the urban middle class. The age of educated women, marriage age of the educated women started increasing. But at the same time, since we are living in patriarchy, the parents are very anxious to get a proper bride, groom for the educated daughter. So what education can do? It can reduce the fertility rate. It can enhance the household nutrition. These are the positives. It can check population explosion. It can provide nutrition. Educating children, reducing child mortality, alleviating poverty. But however, dowry is increasing because of education. Increased demands of dowry for the educated and employed bride's family to pay according to Dalmia study. More educated girl means more dowry parents will have to pay. Dalmia study. So education is not just altering the social structure, education is also reinforcing patriarchy. Increasing dowry to be paid for the educated daughter a study by Dalmia. So when girl becomes educated, then parents are very much suffering from anxiety to find a proper match. More dowry, more anxiety for the parents. But however, there is also a perception that if girl gets educated, if wife is educated, then she will challenge the husband's domination, right? So educated women are facing this problem that husband is perceiving that educated wife is definitely going to challenge her patriarchy, challenge the patriarchy. It threatens the patriarchal values, that is husband's inherent superiority is threatened by education. So education is having a paradoxical consequence. On one hand, it is improving the lot of the women, at the same time it is reinforcing patriarchy, is what is found by Coley in a study 2012. Development, oppression, empowerment, equality, inequality, patriarchy exist together. So this point can also be added to modernity and tradition coexisting.